I think an interesting comment was made. I think one of the first ways of creating accountability for government is to force government, anyone in the government, to send their kids to government schools. That might kind of change what's happening in government schools. I think the findings are largely on the wall that private schools do provide better education, the teachers are more accountable, and we do have better outcomes. I am looking at, when I came to India to change the quality of education in India, I did have to start with the elite space because that's the only way you can get funded. And we've sort of put thousands of hours of manned research into what we do is, in terms of delivery of content from using brain science and brain research and the understanding of that for the teacher. There are lots of things I think the government and private sector can do together. I visited Delhi recently, and I'd offer my my methodology to, you know, to low-cost schools for free, because that's the incentive. I mean, I came here to create that difference, but because of the regulations and so many bottlenecks, and I guess so much of resistance and fear that government have in allowing private players to come into even joining hands with government, we kind of just always get blocked, even though our incentive is not for profit. It is actually to reach out and help more and more kids. I think there will be a middle road, at least the RTE Act. I mean, and you can't debate that every child in India has got the right to education. It's just, I think, has to be thought through with government and private players and actually come to a platform where it can be a true private-public partnership. I've been approached by a PE company recently whose prime mission is a social enterprise, and they are looking at affordable housing and investing money in that and using the research and methodology so far created to scale those kind of schools. And that's the only kind of private equity you'd look at because it's got a social enterprise cause for being there. It's not going to ask for quick returns, although it's going to make you accountable for the money being spent, which is where the problem is with the government. You know, you've got huge funding that the government's sitting on, but the accountability for that funding is sort of missing.
So just one point since you mentioned it. Are you saying you're wary of private equity funding in your organization?
Depending on, so far the kind of private equity funding that I met with, and maybe I've just met the wrong kind of
fund. Yeah, all the right guys are sitting here.
were completely tying me up in knots as to, you know, what I would deliver in terms of the finance. I mean, education, anytime you set up a school, it's a 5-year.
Yeah, yeah. So, and I've been told 10 years as well. Anyway, so let's, on that fine note, let's go to Vishal. So, Vishal, I think what you're perhaps looking for is someone with a lot of passion and conscience, but I think the same person is wary of being invested in by funds like you, I mean, as a starting point.
At least I'm on the good side, so I'm also a social fund. Song is a social fund, and we are looking at basically investing in companies which are solving critical socio-economic development challenges which India faces. You know, and a lot of folks on the panel have talked about, if you look at India and look at the consumer segmentation, you know, like 4%, 5% are rich, 20-25% middle class, and maybe 30-35% aspirers, and rest are 50% folks are deprived segment. And the mass, or the Aam Aadmi, which we call it, is the deprived and aspirers segment who are making like 15,000 rupees or less income per month. Family income could be more. So our purpose at Song is to look at what kind of businesses which we can invest in, which can help improve the quality of life of the Aam Aadmi. And in that context, we have decided to invest in all the basic services, whether it's healthcare, education, agri-tech, infra services, the areas where Aam Aadmi life is going to get positively affected. So if you look at education, specifically what we're talking about here, education, as I look at, and I was in the US for 18 years, I came back and I started looking at education space and trying to understand how it works. And so my, without spending money on McKinsey research, it's been like, if you look at like the core and the non-core, core is kind of the biggest part of education system, and non-core has been growing a lot, and mostly I think because the core doesn't work in India. It's because, you know, parents like me say that the core K-12 education is not working, and so I need tuition. My maths is not taught in school properly. That's the reason I need to go to IIT, to Fidji or somebody like that to learn basics of maths and science. So at Song, what we said, like, this is the landscape it looks like in the Indian context. So we need to innovate, and if we have to improve quality of life, it has to be either we target to the core sector, which is K-12, or we target on sectors like vocational industries where jobs can be created in the segment. So those are the two areas which we're focusing on. And I'm a huge believer, I think if appropriately a government and private partnership can happen, and people innovate in a price point in K-12 to deliver highest quality education for that particular price point, I think then people will not be like roaming around in Bombay giving 10,000 rupees for learning English in 1 month, because which is practically impossible to learn English in 1 month, because it's a 12-year process in K-12 which needs to teach English, right? And so I'm very passionate about this thing, and that's an area where we are focusing on.
So just one quick question. So I mean, you talked about price points. I mean, given what private schools were spending.
You know, but before that, just allow me to respond, actually, because this is a point that Lina raised, and this is a conference as much for entrepreneurship, right, as it is for education. And I wear two hats. I'm an investor. I'm also an entrepreneur. You know, I started investing when I was 14, and I became an entrepreneur when I was 20. And so therefore, in some ways, I empathize with what you said. And, you know, so if you look at all enterprises that survive for more than 4 years, 90% of them get funded by customers. So let's first of all understand that, you know, getting funded by VCs is not a litmus test of entrepreneurship. So if we have entrepreneurs in here, some would-be entrepreneurs, if you're getting funded by customers, actually that's a much better situation. So in fact, I would say some of the world's most valuable companies have been funded by customers. More valuable companies have been funded by customers than by PE. The remaining 10% that get funded by financial capital, 90% get funded by non-formal financial capital, right? Which is non-PE, non-VC type, which what you just said is high net worth, angels, your friends, family, relatives, everybody with whom you have personal credibility. You beg, borrow, steal. Not steal, so you can steal from your mom, but you can't steal from others, right? And I would go one step further, that I would say that when it comes to core education, private equity has inherent limitations in being able to fund core education. Because it takes 10 years to build a good school, maybe more. It takes 20 years to build a good college or university. And there is no short circuit to that. And you know, private equity has severe limitations. You know, we are creatures of with severe limitations. So there are very large parts of education for which private equity itself needs to change in order to be more relevant. In terms of price point, again, this is a story that needs to be propagated. As we all know, that central government in India runs only a few thousand schools. The bulk of the schools are run by state and municipal governments. Data on
kind of conflict that you're really talking about. Look at it from a parent's perspective. Do you really want? I'm not even talking about government schools right now, because the problem with government schools is, and let's admit it, there are a few government schools that are good, that are better than private schools. There are many Kendriya Vidyalayas in the country, many Navodaya Vidyalayas do an outstanding job of education. The problem with government, by and large, is that they have lost credibility and the trust of the middle class in this country. And not only that, they've even lost the credibility and trust of the people who cannot afford private sector education. So the people who cannot afford private sector education are waiting for the day when they can raise their income and they put their child into a private school. Now, Educomp has gone and set up, we have a brand of school called Universal Academy Schools, for which we charge 700 to 800 rupees a month. And these schools are all in rural areas. They are in places like Kashipur, Baspur, Gadarpur in Uttaranchal, in rural Mewat in Haryana, in Hatin, Pulwana, Dadri. These are some places a lot of people, you may not even have heard of these places. And our thesis when we went to these places was that the only competition we have is a free government school. And we are coming in at a price point which is seemingly very high. 800 rupees per student per month, where the competition is free, is it even going to work? And there are lines outside a school even before the school has actually officially opened. So what is this telling you? This is telling you that the price debate is in our minds here. For the parent out there, whether he's paying 800 rupees or 1500 rupees, the value that he's...
Well, and let me play the villain here because it's more fun to play. There are a lot of trusts out there which are making tons of money in education, tax-free. In fact, there are a couple of well-known private universities which are earning something like in excess of 600 crores a year. Now, the funny thing is that, like what Shantanu was saying, is that Gopal, is that most of this funding is coming from student fees. So the thing is that when a company comes to me, or let's say when a trust comes to us for investment, our problem is never, okay, do you have a business model? Or do you have enough students who are willing to pay for your education? My problem is, how do I clean up the balance sheet? So therefore, as an entrepreneur, it's very, very lucrative for me to start an educational trust because I can get great cash flow. Let me also clarify something about education. It's one of the very, very few businesses where you get your money up front, the student fees at the beginning of the year. After that, your expenses start. Once you build up a certain brand name, you don't have to market that much anymore because people are coming to you. And unlike the hotel industry, it's 100% occupancy throughout the year. And once you've got that kid with you at the beginning of the year, at standard one, then you have that customer for you for 10 years. So, you know, really, it's a very, very good cash flow model. But I really would look at, again, the problem is that I can't invest money in these trusts. Even though the entrepreneurs are making piles of money, there's a guy who actually came to us, you know, a classic example. A guy came to us a few months ago. Young fellow, 32 years old. He started his first college at the age of 22. Today he runs seven institutions in the middle, in Madhya Pradesh, 37 crore investment, 37 crore revenue per year. Young, not even that educated himself. But the point is that there are a lot of entrepreneurs out there like that. But the point... Sure. I mean, I have no issues with Me Too people making money, but the question is that, are you starting a lifestyle business? Let's say, for example, should I start a restaurant? There are plenty of restaurants out there. So the question is that, do you want to be a Me Too company and earn enough money to, let's say, drive around in a Bentley and make your, give your wife a lot of jewelry? Or do you actually want to create a game changer that has a chance to scale all of India? Education is still a very regional business. Very few pan-India players so far.
Okay. I just want to collect all the questions. Yeah,
yeah.
Go ahead.
You learn as much money as you want, which would be the extra income, as you said. Set up a trust and do something. Me gave you the exact statement that you said, that there are many parents out there who are ready to pay any amount that you want in the market in terms of education. Now my question is, based on whatever debate is happening here, is that an ethical way to start a school? And where do you find that balance when you debate about government regulations and law? And then how do you see government trying to frame the right laws, if not arguing what is which this kind of temptation?
Any more questions? Yes.
Just a thought.
Can we have some more microphones here? Go ahead.